My name is Raya. Tuck, tuck. You're getting a little too big for this, bud.
Hi, I'm Kelly.
I'm Marva.
And I'm Alex. Today we're going to be reviewing Raya and the Last Dragon for Generation.
Woo! In case you haven't heard about it yet, Raya and the Last Dragon is the newest Disney animated film by Walt Disney Pictures and Walt Disney Animation Studios, directed by Don Hall and Carlos Lopez Estrada. Framed as another Disney princess film along the lines of Elsa in Frozen and Moana in Moana, Raya is set in the fictional land of Kumandra. The basic premise is that 500 years ago, dragons and humans coexisted in peace, until a bunch of monsters called the Druun came and ravaged the land, turning people to stone. The dragons came together and sacrificed themselves to banish the Druun and keep the humans safe. However, because of a conflict between humans 500 years later, the monsters are back and it's up to our heroine Raya to save everyone by finding the last living dragon, Sisu. This movie was technically released simultaneously in theaters and online, but because of the existing pandemic, Kelly, Alex, and I, Marva, watched it through Disney Plus Premier Access.
In this review, we want to talk about our personal experiences and thoughts about the film, and take a look at its approach to Asian American representation, specifically with regards to Southeast Asian representation. This review will get into some spoilers, but before we do that, we want to talk about the people who made this film. Although the primary screenwriters, Quy Nguyen and Adele Lim, and the head of story, Phan Veerasunthorn, are of Southeast Asian descent, there is a critical lack of Southeast Asian representation in the rest of the cast and crew. Within the main cast, the only Southeast Asian people with speaking roles are Kelly Marie Tran as Raya and Isaac Wong as Boon. Let me contextualize that a little bit better. The rest of the cast is Gemma Chan, Daniel Dae Kim, Benedict Wong, Sandra Oh, and Awkwafina as the dragon. I'll talk about this again later, but it's so strange how Disney intentionally marketed this film as a Southeast Asian film when the voices of the people portrayed are almost entirely East Asian.
Moreover, none of these people are voice actors by profession. These are very recognizable names from the live action world when they could have chosen Southeast Asian talent to match up with the characters on screen.
The first thing I noticed right off the bat is that this story takes place in a made-up world that is supposed to resemble Southeast Asia without tying it down to a specific country or culture. Raya lives in the city of Heart, which is one of the five cities that makes up the region of Kumandra. Put together, the cities of Heart, Tail, Spine, Talon, and Fang make up one big, you guessed it, dragon. Cheesiness aside, I was honestly a little disappointed, though I can't say I was surprised. The only AAPI-centered Disney movies that don't take place in a made-up city are Mulan and Lilo and Stitch, and Mulan isn't even an original story. Moana takes place on a fictional Polynesian island, Big Hero 6 is set in San Francisco, and Aladdin is the prince of the fantasy kingdom of Agrabah. When you compare this to The Princess and the Frog in New Orleans, Beauty and the Beast in France, and Brave, which is very clearly set in Scotland, it makes you wonder why Raya and these other Asian stories are treated differently. When Disney announced this film to the public as a representation of Southeast Asia, they defended their decision of keeping Kumandra's location ambiguous by saying that the easy thing we could have done was, this land in Kumandra was Thailand, this was Vietnam, this one's Malaysia, but then it gets into a really ugly place of going, oh, well this country's bad, and this one's good, and our hero's from here. I think that this logic is definitely understandable, especially given the messages of unity that are spread throughout the movie. However, on the other side of that argument, it's hard to claim that your story serves as representation for Southeast Asia when no singular country is properly represented.
A big part of making a story accurate is the world building, like the environments, clothes, architecture, body representation, and food. I want to use Mina Lee's breakdown of the fashion in this movie as a representation of the approach that the Disney team took with this movie's world building as a whole. It's very evident that they did research here. Mina pulls up references for every single garment worn by the main characters, and they all tie back to Southeast Asian characters. But I would like to ask, to what end? Although you can tie in every piece of clothing worn to a real piece of clothing, we can see that the architecture of Fang looks like the architecture of Angkor Wat, but what was the point of putting together so many references if the vast majority of the audience would not be able to understand it? It makes sense that people from each country can point out the elements inspired by their culture, but what does it say on the global scale when this movie generalizes Southeast Asian culture to such a degree?
To be fair, Southeast Asia is a fairly unified and interrelated area. 10 out of 11 countries in the area are members of ASEAN, or the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, which functions similarly to other economic unions in the world, such as the EU. We also have a lot of annual cultural and sporting events among the nations, such as the SEA Games or AFF Cup. The area perhaps was even more closely connected before colonialism and invasion of multiple Western forces. Wait, does that mean that Dune is a metaphor for colonialism and Disney is actually attacking imperialism and white supremacy? No way. Nonetheless, with 11 official languages, each and every country is unique and distinct from one another, culturally and socio-economically. To further add to the pointlessness of Disney's melting pot method of representation, I would like to point out that outside of the few countries that is controlling the pandemic to an extent for full-scale theater premiere, my own country included, Raya is solely accessible through Disney+, a platform that is available to less than half of the country in Southeast Asia. This prevents those people who might actually get the homage from seeing their cultures shown on screen, denying them the chance to see characters that look like those around them in a big-budget Disney animation. Of course, we do not know what Disney's intention truly is in this decision, but I would argue that it is based on the assumed profitability of this area, which means that the mountain's finest exotic enough to be made into a movie, but not lucrative enough to see that movie.
This movie is called Raya and the Last Dragon, so you would think that the dragons in this movie would be accurate to at least one culture. But as you can see, here are Thai dragons, here are Vietnamese dragons, here are Malaysian dragons, but instead we got a furry cross between Elsa and Sully from Monsters, Inc., voiced by Awkwafina and her black son. This is what different Southeast Asian dragons look like. This is what we got. Even Mushu from Mulan looked physically accurate, albeit with the explanation that due to his reduced power, he simply became the wrong size. The dragons played such a huge part in this story. The land itself is shaped like a dragon, but why couldn't they make them look accurate or even just not like a children's toy? They framed Raya and Namari as dragon nerds so that Sisu literally became a kind of icon between the two of them, and I guess also so that kids would be able to kind of grab on and relate to being a dragon nerd too. Additionally, the only dragon with a speaking role, being Awkwafina, made it really awkward every time she talked.
At its core, this movie is targeted towards children, so it does its best to offer a moral of sorts, though I think it does a mediocre job of actually getting it across. The first theme offered to us is unity. From the start, Raya's father talks about uniting Kumandra once again and is ridiculed by the other cities for it. But after the Drun are defeated and the dragons are restored, the other cities realize the error of their ways and are willing to unite once again. The issue, though, is that we didn't see that willingness to unify from Fang throughout the entire movie, even when the Drun were running rampant through the city. Does Namari somehow convince her mother to completely sacrifice her priority of self-preservation just for the sake of unity? Does the reemergence of the dragons change her outlook on bringing Kumandra back? Her motives for changing her mind are unclear, so even though I understand that Disney movies need to have a happy ending, it didn't seem like there was enough substance to warrant it. The second theme is trust. We watch as Raya's naivete is shattered by Namari's betrayal. We follow her in her journey to restore Sisu's power, jaded by the trauma of being taken advantage of, losing her father, and losing her home. Sisu, unlike Raya, is filled with blind trust to the point of almost getting killed by a Drun because she followed a stranger to the outskirts of the city. The climax of the story requires Raya and her team to put blind faith in Namari. Keep in mind, she just shot Sisu, who was only trying to help her, to defeat the Drun once and for all. Though the message was probably that Raya had a responsibility to seek the unity her father wanted all along, and that she had to learn to trust again in order to restore Kumandra, it also puts into question the way we portray trauma. Despite being betrayed twice by Namari, the narrative puts the onus on Raya's shoulders to take the high road and trust her worst enemy at the most crucial moment. What message does that send to younger audiences that have been wronged by others? How does this portrayal of trauma influence kids? To prevent myself from getting too serious over a children's movie, Imagine yourself as a kid who just got a really cool toy. You share this toy with your new friend who steals it intentionally and breaks it in pieces. Obviously, your trust would be shattered, and you wouldn't want to share toys with that kid ever again. But the moral of this story implies that you should give your piece of the toy to that same kid again so that she can have not a second, but a third chance to prove that she's not a bad person. As much as trust is a good lesson to teach to young kids, I don't think that this is the right way to get it across.
Arguably, trying to be a bigger person is a good lesson and possibly a good solution to most conflicts. Nonetheless, it is still very harmful to blame people with trauma for not living up to this difficult standard. Raya is deeply wounded psychologically by Nomari, having her father and everyone she knows and loves taken away from her, all because she decided to trust Nomari. Allowing her to be blamed by Nomari and the audience without even an apology for all the pain she received, then forcing her to do the exact thing that caused her all the pain in the first place might be a step far too cruel to teach a lesson.
There was probably a really strong story and plot behind this movie when it was first pitched, and the writers probably had a lot of research and passion for this project. I don't want to discredit any of the producers who are clearly putting in efforts for representation of the Southeast Asian community, but when you have to sell this to a global audience, people often make you water down your ideas in order to make them more marketable. They take out what they think won't sell them toys and they substitute it with what will.
This was a cool movie that Disney clearly spent a lot of money on, but kind of sneakily left it out as a snack on the table, expecting no one to actually consume the content.
Given the lack of access in Southeast Asia, plus the lack of promotion in the US, I probably wouldn't have known about this movie and its issues if it weren't for Twitter. The overwhelming sentiment from what I can see about this movie is that it needed to be grounded in reality, with a real myth to draw from, and a real country of people to respect and honor the culture of. Without that, Disney ignores the real-world impact and the implications of representation in media. We do not exist in a vacuum.
Instead of the list of big names for the cast, they could have used voice talents from Southeast Asia with Southeast Asian accents. I myself, who start learning and speaking English since age 4, still have an accent, as do many Americans of Southeast Asian descent. Why can the way we talk also appear in a movie that was made to represent us? This, in my opinion, is the most powerful form of representation that Disney passed up on.
So, if you made it this far, thanks for watching our review of Raya and the Last Dragon. Let us know in the comments below if you have any thoughts, and feel free to shoot us an email or a DM on social media at NYU Generation. If you like this video, please like, subscribe, and turn on that notification bell. We'll see you next time.
Bye.